All right. So thank you so much for the invitation. It's nice to see a few familiar names and faces. And special call out actually to Scott Hubel, who I see in the audience, who is an undergraduate in my lab working on this topic maybe 2 or 3 years ago now. It's hard to keep track of time. But I'll highlight a little bit about what he did since it's nice to see him here. So yeah, I'm excited today to talk about some of our work on quantum memory. Like Alan said, it's sort of one of the directions in my group. We've actually got a few different things going on. So let me just, before I get into the details, talk a little bit about each of them. So we do have a project in BC in quantum simulation, which is more my background, my history of what I've done over my career. So we are continuing to work in that and finding ways actually to combine that with some of this other work we've done. But in recent years, we've sort of fallen into this topic of quantum memory in large part through the collaborations that we formed here in Alberta and through the work of my postdoc, Aaron Sagomirek. So I do want to spend some time talking about that. But just as an overview, we're also working on a hybrid quantum system, which is a long-term project that's sort of in the engineering phase right now. But the idea is to combine an ultracold atoms machine, which is under construction, with a dilution refrigerator, which is ordered and on the way any day now, combining the expertise with John Davis's ultra low temperature group to actually put cold atoms in cryogenic environments for various quantum technology applications. So that's sort of the hybrid quantum system that we're talking about. And I might get a little bit of time at the end to talk about the microwave atom optics. So this is where the warm or lukewarm atoms come in. And it's started off sort of as a series of undergraduate projects, but has taken on the role of a whole PhD thesis now, looking at how we can use warm atoms as well as the cold atoms to do some interesting sort of technological applications there. So, but with that, let me focus on the quantum memory. So this is the sort of basic idea that we have of the quantum memory in our lab. We have some kind of storage medium. In our case, it's the atoms, and in particular rubidium atoms. And the idea here is that we have some kind of input signal, and this is where we're going to sort of get our information from, and in the future, hopefully that will be quantum information. We want to store it inside this memory medium, and we're going to use a control mechanism to do so. And then after some storage time, we actually have a way to, on demand, release that information back into the same optical signal that it started out as. So this is the sort of very cartoon picture of where we're going with the quantum memory. Now, why somebody might want a quantum memory, there's sort of a lot of different applications that one can think about. I've sort of drawn a map of a quantum internet, if you will, of some of the different applications. Maybe the nearest term application is as a quantum repeater. These, of course, are necessary to circumvent problems of long distance quantum communications and some of the losses that occur in, say, optical fibers. You want a repeater sort of measure and then send again the quantum information. And the memory might be an important part of that object because synchronization will be important. You need to be able to do these Bell state measurements at the exact same time. And so the memory can help you sort of receive information from one place and wait until you get the signal from somewhere else in order to do that measurement. Another possible application is in turning, say, spontaneous single photons into a deterministic one. So if you can imagine some process that creates single photons that's random, if you send one of those, say, into a quantum memory and you can use a Herald, say, of another one to tell you when to store it, you can store that photon until you need it later, and then you actually have an on-demand memory, which might be a nice application to have a higher efficiency single photon source. Another possible application, of course, is as sort of a memory mechanism for an actual quantum computer. This is a longer-term application because we're sort of still working in the single qubit kind of storage right now. Of course, that's going to have to get a lot denser, but the idea of quantum memory is going to be necessary for that. And then, of course, there's a number of other applications that have more to do with actually just processing information that is held in electromagnetic fields. So some of the applications we've looked at are in temporal beam splitting and in converting wavelengths. So the same kind of mechanisms that are used for quantum memory can be used to do these things. And that's sort of where the manipulation part of the title comes in here. So these, of course, are not my ideas. There's a long history of using quantum memories and thinking about what they might be good for. And there's actually a couple of good review articles down here if that's something you're interested in reading more about. Quantum memory is also not a new idea. It's something that's been done with atoms even for about 20 years now. Some of the earliest papers came out of Harvard In particular, looking at electromagnetically induced transparency in atoms and how that might be used for a quantum memory. So that was done with cold atoms, but very soon it was realized you can do it with warm atoms, which warm to me just means room temperature, but also in things like ion doped solids or NV color centers and other color centers are also good candidates for quantum memory, as well as things like optomechanics and superconducting devices. There's a whole plethora of places that people can use, things that people can use to make a quantum memory. In addition to the sort of variety of media, there's also a variety of mechanisms that people use, and largely these can be classified into two classifications. Some nice work by Alexei Gorshkov in his PhD looking at this. One classification is as an adiabatic memory, which means you sort of slowly transform the state from the photonic degree of freedom into the memory and then back again. And EIT is usually the preferred mechanism to do this, although there are other mechanisms, including this one called off-resonant Raman, to do that. These are slow because they are adiabatic, and so that is one of their main limitations, but they are very efficient. Fast memories, on the other hand, are faster, which is good. Generally, these use absorption, and they rely on sort of the excitation and then some kind of inhomogeneous phase evolution of the emitters, but that means that after some regular time that these emitters will rephase and then they'll release their signal once again. They'll sort of re-emit the signal. And that is done usually at a predetermined time. And that's the difference between the two memories, but it can be fast, it can be broadband, and it can be done with a sort of very large variety of media. So there's advantages and disadvantages to both sort of classifications.
Hi, Lindsay, can I ask sure. a question? Gamon Laflamme speaking.
Hi.
When you mention fast and slow, can you give us an idea of what you mean by fast and slow?
Yes. So the adiabatic memories typically work on maybe definitely milliseconds, but maybe as fast as microseconds. I mean, sort of the pulse length that they can store. EIT is restricted because you have to create what's called a transparency window in the frequency domain. And generally that's very narrow in the frequency domain, and you have to sort of fit your signal inside of that, which means a very narrow frequency or a long time signal. Fast memories can work in sort of nanosecond, sort of gigahertz frequency regimes now. So pretty fast, but again, that's something we still wanna keep pushing on.
Okay, great, thanks.
So yeah, that sort of, bandwidth and multiplexing is one of the areas of performance that we're considering when thinking about how to do this. One of the important sort of bandwidth considerations is actually matching the memory to the single photon source. In the case of optical memories, a lot of single photon sources are quite broad bandwidth and actually are not compatible with these adiabatic or EIT. So that's where some of the other types of memories come in there. But other factors are things like efficiency. So if you send a signal in, are you gonna get it back? The storage time and how long you can hold on to that. So probably for practical applications, you'll need to get to milliseconds to seconds timescales, which some technologies have demonstrated. Ours isn't quite there yet, but that's sort of what you need to get those, for the repeater distances that we're talking about, for instance. And then noise and fidelity. So basically the question is, are you sure that the signal you're reading is the signal that you put in? And depending on the medium you're using, there could be different mechanisms for giving spurious signals. And so those are the different considerations one needs to think about. So what I want to talk about today is a quantum memory that we're working with in my lab, which we call the Autler-Townes protocol. So this is the way of doing it. It combines aspects of both the fast and slow memories, and as a result, it has actually a very nice combination of all these different criteria, including the fact that it's fairly broadband, it's actually very low noise, it's fairly efficient, not as efficient as some other things, and it's capable of long storage times, though we're still in the process of actually getting there. And so I'm going to go ahead and spend some time explaining exactly how this works. Okay, so here's an outline for the rest of the talk. I'll talk about this Autler-Townes memory and what the sort of protocol behind it is. I'll talk about some of the experiments that we've done demonstrating this, and then move on, time permitting, to talk about some of the outlook. And if there isn't enough time, I'm happy to answer questions about this more informally later too. So to start, let's talk about this Autler-Townes protocol. The basic problem is, how do you transfer a qubit or some information from a photonic degree of freedom, starting with some empty atomic degree of freedom, to emptying that photonic degree of freedom and then getting that information into the atomic sector. So I don't know why that doesn't work, but what we're going to consider is a simple three-level system in what we call a lambda configuration. So if you're an experimentalist and want some context, this is a rubidium atom, but the basic idea is that it's a three-level system where these two levels here comprise a forbidden transition, and that means that they can form a nice storage state because we can create a superposition between these two levels, and there's no, in this case, electric dipole transition that connects the two of those levels. So in rubidium, those are the two hyperfine ground states of our atom, which are separated by some gigahertz, 6.8 gigahertz. But in principle, it can be any transition that has a long lifetime that allows you to have this storage. For us, it's long because there's no electric dipole transition connecting them. So to actually get the information across, we need a two-photon transition, and we're going to access that through an excited state. And so we have sort of two different laser beams that interact with these atoms. We're going to call one of these the signal transition. So this arm here is going to represent the transition where the information is coming in on. And we're going to consider that as sort of an electric field. In a lot of the formalism are associated with this, this field is the actual quantum optical field, as opposed to the second field here, which is the control transition. And this, we don't really need to consider the quantum optics of it. It's just a large electric field in our case. And so we're just going to represent that by the Rabi frequency associated with that transition. And the idea here is that we can use this arm as a control that can turn the memory on and off. And this one will be how we absorb the information into the atoms. So we work with what we call ATS memory. So this is Autler-Townes splitting, ATS. And basically it's the same thing as AC Stark splitting, if you know what that is. The idea is that if you have a three-level system and you drive one of those transitions very strongly, we can actually think about this driven system in a new dressed basis where we have two new levels that are now superpositions of the original levels and a splitting that is exactly equal to the Rabi frequency associated with the laser that's doing that driving. So if you look at an absorption of this signal beam, which is the sort of G to E transition here, originally it would be this dashed line, some Lorentzian absorption feature, but as you drive that transition, you get a splitting, and that splitting is just related to the strength of the laser. So we're going to work in this regime where that splitting is strong and where we get this very, very wide splitting here. And that regime happens when the drive is actually stronger than the spontaneous emission line width associated with the transition. So basically, as soon as the splitting is bigger than the signal, a single absorption line width, then you're in this regime. So just to show that we can do that, we can turn our laser power up. And to give you some context, that's about 3 milliwatts in our case. So not a lot of power. And of course, that depends on how big your focus is. It's, you know, nothing drastic here. We're sort of on this 500 microns or a millimeter width of the laser beam. So we can get this Autler-Townes splitting regime fairly readily in our rubidium atoms. Okay, so let's go back to the three-level system here and talk about how to get information into the atoms. So to do that, I want to consider two different quantities, which I'll call coherences. The first one is the polarization coherence. So I'm going to use a measure, which this isn't, there's an actually the Hermitian conjugate here too, but basically an operator that measures the projection from G to E. So in very layman's terms, this is actually like a measure of the superposition. So how much coherence we have here is going to be represented by this polarization operator. And we can do the same thing with a spin coherence. And it's called spin just because of history, of course, but these are sort of pseudo spin levels. And we can do the same thing and measure what the coherence is between these two levels here. So these are the two quantities I want to consider instead of populations of the levels. I want to consider the coherences. And then the thing that connects them is this control field that drives the Autler-Townes splitting that I talked about earlier. So we can write down a set of equations known as the Maxwell block equations. I'm not going to go through these, but they're basically the dynamics of the electric field. Remember, that's the field where the signal is, the dynamics of the polarization, so this superposition, and the dynamics of the spin. And they depend on each other and various couplings that depend on the laser fields and things like that. So we're going to simplify this by going to the ATS limit and making some assumptions. And when we do that, we get a very simple set of equations where the electric field, the polarization, and the spin degrees of freedom depend on each other in a fairly simple way. And this is just a cartoon model. We can solve the full set of equations. But if you look at this set of equations here, this is just the derivative of P is proportional to S, and the derivative of S is proportional to P. And I can give this problem to my undergraduates, cross my fingers and hope they can solve it, but it's just a harmonic solution of these coherences. And so if I plot a very simple model of this, what I've got is if I send in an electric field, it basically drives the polarization. So the electric field comes in, it basically creates an electric dipole moment between these two levels, which creates my polarization. And then because I've got this harmonic term here, I just get a harmonic sort of oscillation between the polarization coherence to spin coherence, to polarization to spin, and back and forth again. So these two things are out of phase from one another. And then every time the polarization is reestablished, you establish an electric dipole moment, which radiates, and that radiation turns itself back into an electric field. So you get some electric field back out every time there's a polarization. And so this is a very simple model, but what you can think of it is really just Robbie flopping, not between necessarily between these two levels, although that is actually happening. Send a strong pulse on, you're just going to get a two-level system oscillating. But actually, it means that the polarization and the spin coherence Robbie flop, they oscillate with each other. And the period for doing that is just going to be related to the strength of this control field that we're sending in here. And so how we turn that into a memory is by just considering the re-emission of the light. So this is a more realistic calculation where we've included all the terms that I approximated out earlier in the simple model. And the light pink represents an electric field coming in. The blue line represents the control field. So that's just left on all the time in this case. And then the dark pink is the electric field that is emitted. And with apologies that these are in a different order. So we send in the electric field or the photonic coherence that creates the polarization. Those are basically in phase, which is then out of phase with spin, back to polarization. And that means a field is re-emitted after one period. And that's what this re-emission bump here is, this electric field that comes out. And you can actually see there's some echoes at longer times that are associated with the spin and the polarization continuing to oscillate back and forth with one another. So that's sort of like the, very much like the fast memories based on absorption that we saw earlier. And that's where this is related to that kind of memory, is that we've sort of got this re-emission cycle that is periodic and is related to the strength of the laser beam that we're sending in. To turn this into an on-demand memory though, the nice thing about this kind of system is that we can turn off the control. So if we just do that sharply, then if we control, we turn off the control as soon as the polarization has disappeared and we have a full or as much spin coherence as we can get in the atoms, and then we turn the control back on and that starts the oscillation going again. Assuming that there's no loss during the storage time, then we get a photonic coherence and we get our electric field back out. And so we see the re-emission of the light after a user-controlled storage time. The nice thing about this memory that's a little bit different than the other fast memories is that we have control over these laser pulses and control over how this re-emission happens. And one of the features is that it doesn't matter what the shape of this control field is when we go for re-emission. It's just that you have to cover one Robbie period, and it doesn't matter if you do that in any kind of pulse shape that you want, but as long as the integral of the electric, basically is proportional to electric field over time, has to satisfy an area condition in the units that we use, that's 2 pi. And what that means is that you go from having coherence in polarization to spin. And so you can do that with whatever pulse shape you want. And we just showed with some nicer Gaussian pulses, you can kind of shape the output of your pulse here. So you turn on the control, turn it off, store it. And then when you turn it back on again, you can get your pulse out without any of these echoes coming back to haunt you. You do sort of the price you pay here is that you do have to have good control over the control pulse in terms of its timing so that you don't leave any excitation in the polarization degree of freedom, if possible. So there's a couple of questions that people might or have asked in looking at this memory. And one is, how is the information actually stored? The answer is that it's what's called a spin wave memory. And what's happening is that if we think about sort of the single photon level, it's basically a superposition of exciting one atom in that superposition over and the sum over all possible atoms sharing that excitation. So it's basically a collection of all the atoms sharing a single excitation in this kind of a superposition. But the sort of kicker here is that it's a spin wave memory, and that it's actually, you have to take into consideration the interference of the light over space. You end up getting an interference pattern in the atoms. You can think about it a little bit like a hologram, actually, where you have two beams coming in and they form an interference pattern. And that's actually basically imprinting the phase relationship between the two beams into the atoms as places where the light is absorbed and not. And that means that the superposition states sort of change through the cloud. And you can think about the vectors and things like that. And that will tell you what the sort of spacing of this period of this grading is. And that actually depends on things like what the angle is between these two beams. So if they're co-propagating with one another, you get a very long wavelength spin, a spin wave. If you have angles between the two beams, or if they're counter-propagating, that spin wave can be very fine in space. And that matters for some technical reasons we'll talk about later. So yes, if you have some angle, then you have a very fine spin grading here. But that's the sort of mechanism. And you can actually, like I said, think about it like a hologram. You have two beams that come in, they imprint their phase pattern on the atoms based on, you know, the absorption and the phase of the absorption of the, like, the atomic emitters. And then when you come back later with a second control beam, it's a lot like a diffraction grating. You just send the beam in, it diffracts off this diffraction grating that you've created, and you get the original beam out. And that's just like a hologram, where you get the same field out as you put in and get this sort of exact match of the optical field. The second question we often get is, how is this different than EIT? So if people are familiar with EIT, electromagnetically induced transparency, it also works with the same three-level system. And a lot of people have spent a lot of time looking at sort of the connections between EIT and ATS. So maybe let me just, these are a collection of analyses from different papers. But the idea is that maybe this plot is the nicest one to explain it here. If you go from a single absorption peak with EIT, where you have a very narrow transparency window, and as you turn up the control power along this axis, you split the peaks. And that's basically, there's no sharp transition between EIT and ATS here. It's a sort of a crossover between the two regimes. And actually, this is, I mentioned earlier, Scott Hubel, who worked on this, he did a lot of nice simulations during his summer with us looking at this transition in the frequency domain. But the issue is that there's no sharp transition between the two regimes. And you can think about, you know, EIT behavior being this adiabatic memory in one regime and ATS memory being this fast memory in the other. And there's no sharp transition between them. And so that's a question we did spend some time looking at. And this is sort of another picture here. In EIT, you have a very narrow transparency window if you look in this frequency axis here, whereas in the ATS, we actually want our signal in the red here to cover the two absorption peaks. And this is sort of an extreme example with narrow peaks, but we want the broadband signal to be very broad in frequency space for this to work. So we did some simulations of this, and we maybe want to focus on narrowband EIT versus broadband ATS. If you look at the actual dynamics of what's going on, in the EIT case, you have what's called an adiabatic memory. So the thing about EIT is that it does not excite any polarization coherence. And I apologize that these labels are quite small, but this middle panel here is the polarization coherence. So if we go to the far right, this is the same kind of plot I was showing earlier. You send in an electric field, you get a polarization to spin, to polarization to spin, and back and forth. So this is where the broadband ATS memory works. For EIT, you have a very different situation where you send in the electric signal and it slowly transforms into the spin coherence. This is sometimes called the polariton, and it slowly creates the spin wave without exciting any polarization coherence. And this is related to the fact that EIT involves a dark state. So there's that actual quantum interference that prevents any absorption to that excited level. And it means that there's no losses, which is nice, but it's also very slow. So if you look at the timescales here, we actually had to do this simulation 1,000 times slower than we can for the ATS memory. So that's the trade-off here, is speed versus maybe a little bit of loss. So it's a bit of a complicated slide, but it does show that basically the difference is that whether or not you excite this coherence here. So we wanted to compare the ATS versus the EIT memory, and this plot actually summarizes it quite nicely in terms of efficiency. So we've got different bandwidths here. And so what we did in this case is say, we demand that you need a large bandwidth. So you can do large bandwidth EIT memory. Actually, this is on the previous slide. If you separate your peaks very broadly, you can get the same slow light phenomena in the middle with your signal, but you need a lot of power to do it. But what you can see here is that efficiency versus optical depth. So optical depth is kind of like the density of the atoms, how many you need to have. So the efficiency for the ATS memory is in blue here. It shoots up very quickly. So you don't need very much optical depth to get an efficient memory, but it does sort of top out here. So you get to 80% efficiency, and this is about 90% efficiency for these bandwidths of 5 and 10 gamma. So gamma is the line width of the atoms. In our case, it's about 6 megahertz. The EIT memory can get higher efficiency eventually, approaching 100%, but you need much more optical depth, which is a resource that is indeed hard to come by. And so the message here is that if you have sort of low resources, the ATS memory does pretty well for quite a while before the EIT memory can improve it. And the same kind of results are shown in this lower graph, that for low bandwidths, EIT is the more efficient memory, but as you increase the bandwidths, its efficiency decreases in a certain set of parameters, whereas the ATS memory here in blue does better. And again, it's only for some regime of bandwidth, but this is actually quite a practical regime of bandwidth that matches things like single photon sources that are out there. So this is work we sort of explored in depth in a PRA, and Scott's one of the authors on this paper here. So maybe I'll just skip over this, but it just shows basically the same thing, is that EIT memory is good if you have low bandwidth and high optical depth, whereas the ATS memory is preferred if you have higher bandwidths and particular optical depth. So it is really optimal only in a certain regime, but it's in a regime of, I would say, practicality. Okay, so that's enough of the modeling for now. We are experimentalists, so let me tell you a little about the actual work we did in the lab. So here's just a picture with my phone looking at the apparatus. We did these experiments using our ultracold atoms apparatus that actually was designed for the quantum simulation experiments. There's a glass box inside here. You can see some reflections inside, and that's where the science actually happens. We have some magnetic coils that we use to do the magnetic parts of the trapping and cooling, as well as lots of lasers to do the laser cooling. So in the first sets of experiments, we actually used laser-cooled atoms, laser-cooled but not condensed. So we had about 200 million atoms with an optical depth of about 3. So remember that parameter from one of the previous graphs? It was, for EIT to work, this had to be over 100. So 3 was pretty accessible to us. You can see here is a cloud of these atoms, this little pink smudge here. You can actually see it with your eye, but it actually shows up even better on a cell phone camera. So we basically had a very simple setup. We have our MOT here. We send in our signal and control beams. They have cross polarization, so we can mix them on a beam splitter, send them to the atoms, and then separate them again with their polarizations with a signal and a control detection. And the particular levels that we use in the rubidium here are shown. If you are familiar with this, we use the 2 hyperfine ground states and one of the lines on the D2 transition for the rubidium. So this is the sort of first set of results showing that we can do the very simple memory operations that we showed. So we have a signal coming in, we leave the control field on, and we get a re-emission after about 100 nanoseconds. And that's basically controlled by the amount of power that we send in. In this case, parameterized by the Rabi frequency of the ATS splitting. So about 10 megahertz, so that's associated with the 100 nanoseconds. We can instead do this sort of control. So here again, we didn't have the best control for our first experiments, but we shut off the control beam, waited for some time, and then turned it back on, and we see a re-emission of the light. And then we can do that with our pulsed control. And here, sort of in the lab, there's even more sort of preference for using these pulse control or pulse area conditions. We were able to sort of get a much nicer looking pulse out in this case. So these storage times are around 200, 240 nanoseconds, not super long, but not the worst actually either. So I'm going to skip over that, actually. We were able to show that these pulses were coherent with the original signal. So the way we did that was we set in an original signal with a control beam, and then we would wait. And then when we recall the second signal, we'd actually send in another one, which had a phase relationship with the first. And so depending on whether that was sort of in phase with zero relative phase or out of phase with pi relative phase, we would get an enhancement or a suppression of the signal at the output. And that let us do a visibility measurement so that by changing the phase between these signal and the reference pulses, we were able to get a visibility of about 90%. So there is a very strong phase relationship between these two pulses, showing that we do have coherence between the input and the output. We can also use this technique to do pulse shaping. So remembering that we have this pulse area condition, we can change the pulse area to match, say, the bandwidth for different sources. So we just did this for a factor of two in the original experiments. We had a control pulse, which was broad on the write stage and then narrower for readout, so that the input was about two times broader than the output in time. And we can also stretch the pulses to get to narrow the bandwidth as well. So you can have a write pulse that's as narrow and a readout pulse that's as broad, and you can get a stretched output. So we did this a factor of two. We actually have results that are more like a factor of 10. We just haven't really had time to write them up yet. So that's in the works. One of the other interesting ways to manipulate the signals using this technique is through what we call temporal beam splitting. So here is the idea that this memory can sort of act like a beam splitter. So let me just explain this quickly. The idea of the beam splitter is that, okay, say you start with a signal input, that signal can either remain as an electric field signal, or it can turn into the spin wave because you've applied the memory. So we kind of think of like applying a beam splitter as applying the control signal. And so when you do that, when you apply the control signal, you can turn signal into spin wave, or you can actually, at the readout stage, turn spin wave back into signal. So that's shown in this sort of diagram here. The memory operation is basically you start with an electric field, you turn most of that into spin wave, you might have a little bit of leakage as transmission. So this is the first control pulse here. You hold on to that, so the spin wave is being stored, that's like propagation of this arm. And then you apply a second control pulse here, which is a second beam splitter that converts the spin wave back into an electric field. So the simple memory operation can be thought of as these sort of two beam splitters. But what you can do is, instead of applying a full control pulse here, you can basically make things like a 50-50 beam splitter by having a half control pulse here. And you get half of your signal out here, you wait, and then you can apply the sort of full beam splitter in this case, and you get all of your signal out the second time. So you can split it into two output signals that have this phase relationship with one another, but you can choose the time that you could get them out at. And you can do the same thing for more. And we did this for up to four different output signals here, where we could show that we could get sort of the same amplitude of those signals. And we did show that these are also phase coherent, doing a similar method where we this time sent in two electric fields. And depending on the relative phase between these two electric fields, we either get constructive or destructive interference at the output here, showing very sort of quantum optics-like experiments using these beam splitters, simple quantum optics experiments, of course. So that was our first sort of round of experiments. We wanted to move forward thinking more about how this could be used for real quantum technologies. And the next step was to show that this operates at the single photon level. So at the time, and even at present, we don't have a true single photon source in the lab. But what we did is we just used laser pulses that had been seriously attenuated. The one difference with this experiment is that instead of using beams that were nearly collinearly propagating, as shown with this dashed line here, we moved the control pulse so that it was at a significant 75 degree angle to the probe pulse. And that just let us filter out spatially the control pulses so that when we were doing our single photon detections, we didn't have control field light leaking into that degree of freedom. So there is some implications for this, which I'll talk about, but it let us get to a very low noise level for this experiment. And so in this case, we were indeed able to show that we could operate this thing at the single photon level. These are histograms of basically the signal coming in and then the detection events for pulses of light that had on average only 0.1 photons. And so we did a series of noise calibrations with this, and we could show that basically there's very little noise when we would sort of, you know, leave the control beam on but not have atoms, or leave the atoms but not have the probe. And so we could show that we would get a signal to noise ratio of about 40, almost 40 in this case. And that is actually a very good noise characteristics for this kind of memory. The same time, we also showed that we could do the same kind of beam splitting operations at this low light level, and it works just as well as it did before, and among other things. So the last set of experiments and the most recently submitted were using the same technique using a Bose-Einstein condensate. So we have been able to make BECs in the lab since about 2017. They are rubidium BEC condensates. And the motivation for doing this was that with colder atoms, we were hoping that we could get longer storage times, because one of the main mechanisms for the limitation of the storage time is thermal diffusion. So the hope was with colder atoms, we would be able to get away from thermal diffusion. So we showed that. Here's the same kind of results. I haven't got the actual, here. So we have the same, again, at low signal, low photon number pulses, same kind of histograms where we were able to store, this case it was just a 300 nanosecond time, a little bit longer, but we actually see much higher efficiency. So as we cool the atoms, the previous results, I didn't really talk about efficiency, but they were below 10%. As we cool the atoms, we go down in temperature here, and we see efficiencies up to about 30%. The very highest BEC fractions, lowest temperatures, we do see a decrease in efficiency, and I'm going to talk about that in a second. And then these numbers are just showing what the overall density is, so as we cool the atoms. So the one problem with making Bose-Einstein condensates is that the way to make them is to get rid of atoms, because you want to get rid of the high energy atoms and be left with the ones that are colder in a conventional way of doing this. So as you cool, we're actually in these gray squares throwing away a lot of our atoms. Even as we do that, the density is increasing, and density is really the number that matters for memory, because you want your light to be absorbed, but eventually the number of atoms does matter, and we lost so many atoms that the it became a problem. However, there's actually another problem as you get colder, is that the atoms actually also get smaller. So the beam of light that we're sending in at the atoms to be absorbed, if the atoms are a large hotter cloud, does absorb the whole beam. But as the atoms are cooled, they also shrink in their trap. And that means that the light that we're sending isn't completely being absorbed. So this fall off in efficiency here is actually largely due to the effect that the beam of light was just too big, and we were not able to absorb all the light. So the two sets of data here, we've got the red ones with a smaller beam, and the gray points with a larger beam show that this is indeed the effect that we're looking at, and we were able to model it and show that that was the case. So we're working with a 25 micron beam here. It is still pretty big. Our apparatus is such that we can't get these really, really small beams, but we could probably get a beam of closer to 2 or 3 microns in diameter if we worked pretty hard at it. So that is in the next step of things to do, would be to get that beam size down, and we expect that the efficiency would keep going up here if we did so. The nice result from this is that we were able to show that lifetime improved. So as we cool the atoms from like 6 microkelvin down to 300 nanokelvin, we're able to see that the efficiency over time for storage times of now in the sort of microsecond regime is significantly improved. So as we expected, as the atoms got colder, we were able to hold on to that information for longer and longer. And so we're now into this sort of tens of microsecond storage time, which is a lot better than the hundreds of nanoseconds we had earlier. And I'm not going to go into the details here, but we can also see that even over several microseconds, we see some coherence in these spin waves. And the limitation that we think is still here is largely technical. It is the magnetic fields that we've got in the lab are not completely stabilized. And that's something every atomic physics experiment struggles against. But one of these things, again, we have some tricks up our sleeve that we're planning to use to beat that down. Again, with this BEC memory, we see similar noise characteristics. So again, very low noise shown in the black here, and signal to noise ratios that are very high, even for very low photon numbers. And so the main limitation here is still decoherence. So I wanted to spend just a minute thinking about what that is. So the magnetic field inhomogeneity is the thing I just mentioned. If you have any kind of magnetic field gradient across the cloud, the different locations are actually going to have their little clocks ticking at different rates. And the sort of precise phase of the atoms is what holds our information. But if a magnetic field comes along and starts winding phase faster in one part of the cloud than the other, that will destroy the information. So we really need to decrease any magnetic field gradients in the system. The other mechanism for decoherence is thermal. So this is sort of what I've alluded to earlier. When we set up these spin waves, you can think about the sort of this grating that's created, but because of diffusion, it's sort of going to blur itself out over time. If you use one of these really long wavelength spin gratings that you get from co-propagating beams, the grating is bigger, so you have more time before that erasure begins. But if you use angles, as we do in the experiment, you have less time because the grating is just smaller, and so it washes out faster. And the time that you get for the storage due to this thermal dephasing has to do with the temperature. Basically, the speed of the atoms is inversely related to the temperature and the size of that grating, which has to do with this angle that we have in the middle. So I talked earlier about how increasing the angle reduces noise. And so one sort of takeaway from this BEC experiment is that even though the angle reduces the storage time because of the thermal diffusion effect, because we were able to stamp out the thermal diffusion by going to the BEC, we can still have a fairly long storage time, even at this large angle, which lets us have a low noise memory with a relatively long storage time. So maybe if we could get rid of both effects at the same time, we could have the best of all worlds. But at the moment, this is pretty good for us. So one other mechanism that exists is the noise of four-wave mixing. And this comes about because sometimes the three-level system that you have, you want basically to excite, create the spin wave, and then when you're redoing the memory, you send a photon back as a control and you want to get the probe photon back. In considering all of these processes, we often will consider the energy conservation, which is natural, but you also have to consider the momentum conservation of all the different wave vectors and interact with one another. And so for the memory mechanism, everything matches because you see, basically have the same inputs and outputs. But if you think about the four-wave mixing process, what can happen is that instead of the signal photon that you want exciting, you can off-resonantly excite with the control photon, and that creates a spontaneous emission, which creates a spin wave that you don't want. And then you can read out on that spin wave and get a signal back that is there, but it's not the signal that you wanted because it was not created with the original electric field. So basically, to be tricked by this, though, the thing is that the spontaneous emission photon to do phase matching would have to have a wave vector that is actually too long. So it would not have, and you can't match the momentum and the energy of that wave vector if you have one of these angles between, if you have an angle between the input and output beams. If this angle goes down to zero, then the phase matching condition is always satisfied. And so this is actually another reason why going to a higher angle is preferable, is that it can prevent this four-wave mixing noise. This is actually one of the main limitations of many other memory protocols that are out there, especially the ones that use warm atoms. All right, so with all of this taken into consideration, I just wanted to throw this up. This is the last graph in that paper showing what we would predict if we could fix a lot of these problems. So if we could get these smaller laser beam sizes, we expect that the memory efficiencies for like a 1 micron beam can get up to 100%. That's pretty optimistic for our system, but there are many BEC apparatuses, for example, that do have that kind of resolution. So it is possible to get very high memory efficiency in these systems, as well as we can look at how the bandwidth can be improved with lower temperatures. The lifetime, these are the mechanisms I just talked about, can be vastly improved. And because of the differences between this ATS protocol and EIT in terms of how much power you have to use, the four-wave mixing noise, which also depends on how much power you send, is not as bad for the ATS protocol as it is for the EIT protocol by a few orders of magnitude. So just a couple of takeaways there. Overall, we've learned about this memory that it has very high bandwidth. It can be very low noise, has pretty good efficiency, and the BECs can give us a very long lifetime. The lower temperatures mean lower thermal diffusion. So there is a trade-off between the using an angle between your beams to get high spatial periodicity to minimize some of these things, but it does mean more thermal diffusion. The BECs can be less susceptible to magnetic field just because they're smaller. And basically we think we can overcome other decoherence mechanisms with some experimental tricks. So I've got a few minutes left unless you want to jump in and stop me. I will talk a little bit about the other work we've got going on with the microwaves and the warm atoms. So the motivation behind here is just thinking about the structure of the atom. And you know, a lot of talk about microwaves going on in the field of various quantum technologies. And so we wanted to sort of think about, well, can we access the microwave domain with the atoms? So just take a little dive into atomic structure here. Most of the alkali atoms, including the rubidium that we use, have this basic structure where you have two ground states and then a whole bunch of excited states, but you can sort of choose which ones you use. But the thing is that the ground states are connected to these excited states through electric dipole allowed transitions, which means you do have matrix elements between the ground and excited states, but you don't have those same electric field matrix elements for the ground states, but they are magnetic dipole allowed. So these transitions can be driven with oscillating magnetic fields at microwave frequencies. So they're much weaker than the electric dipole transitions by a factor of omega to the cubed, which is the frequency difference. And also because magnetic dipole transitions are about 1,000 times less strong than the electric. So they're much, much weaker, but they're there. And people have been using them for quite some time, including, you know, the cesium clock standard uses this kind of a microwave transition. So cavities are the way to do that. If you can enhance the microwave signal strength, then you can get it to be strong enough to actually use it. We sort of embarked upon this microwave endeavor because our colleagues across the hall were building these cavities to use with optomechanics and superconducting qubit devices where they had similar sort of gigahertz frequency domain. And one of the students was interested in thinking about atomic physics and decided to build us a cavity that was resonant with the hyperfine transition of rubidium. So Clinton Potts is his name. And he designed this cavity, including having a Pyrex cell in the center that would be full of rubidium that is resonant with the hyperfine transition of the rubidium atom. So it's about this big, it's like not similar to a soup can in a lot of ways. And so, you know, it's a macroscopic device, but not too big. And so we're able to do things with atomic physics of the sort of variety that people were doing even back in the 50s, 60s, and 70s when lasers were just being developed and people used lamps and early lasers to do this. So we can see things like Rabi oscillations that are driven by microwaves. You can see that they do damp out pretty quickly and their amplitude's not big. But what we can do is sort of optically pump the atoms, drive the transition for a while, and then optically pump them back, drive the transition for a while. But we can see that as we change the microwave power, that frequency does scale linearly with the square root of the power. And so we are indeed seeing these microwave driven transitions. So we thought a little bit about what we can do with this. And the first experiment we pursued was basically called an atomic radio. And the idea behind it is that when you send two signals in simultaneously, an optical signal on the sort of optical transition and a microwave signal, between the hyperfine states, you can basically sort of transmit something from the microwave field to the optical field. And in our case, that something was an audio signal that works a lot like a radio. And I'll just explain briefly how we do that. If we have just an optical signal and have separated this into the same kind of lambda transition I was talking about with the memory, if you drive the optical signal, spontaneous emission means that you're going to end up with all of your atoms in a dark state that is not connected here. So all of the atoms end up here, and then you just have transparency. So when you send light through the atoms, you've pumped them all out of the state you care about, and most of the light will go through. However, if you turn on the microwave coupling between the ground states, now you can do this optical pumping procedure, and most of them try to fall into the state, but now the microwave signal is repopulating the original ground state, and you have sort of a closed cycle here. And what that means is that the transmission of the light is no longer 100% because you've got atoms back here that are now absorbing some of that light. And the trick behind it all is how the transmission works. Actually, I meant to delete that slide, but if the transmission depends on some parameter, and in that case, it's going to be what this microwave field is doing, you can basically write down a Taylor series expansion that says, okay, well, the transmission is going to depend on that parameter and how that parameter changes in time. And if we're thinking about in the frequency domain, the coefficient that tells us how that changes doesn't really matter so much. We just need to, if we only really care about how it changes in time and what the frequency spectrum is, we don't so much care what this prefactor is. And so this sort of first order Taylor expansion gets us where we want to go. And so the idea of what we did is we took a source and we literally just took music and we used that to modulate our microwave source. So we used it in sort of AM amplitude modulation and FM frequency modulation, modulated the signal. We sent it into the cavity either through a wire or through an antenna as kind of a gimmick to show it's a little bit like a radio, and then sent that microwave signal into the cavity and then sent an optical signal through the cavity. We could actually drill holes in the side of the cavity without affecting its quality factor very much and detecting the signal on the photodiode. And so what we could see is that we would send in a song and the original signal looks something like this. And then whether we send in an AM or FM signal, we could get a song out that looked a lot like the song that sent in. And in true Canadian fashion, my students sent Justin Bieber as the first demonstration of this signal. So that was sort of the first atomic radio experiment that we did. But the idea here is that we could use different protocols that are a bit more involved, but ones that we could think about actually transferring not just audio signals, but actually from microwave, real signals in the microwave domain to real signals in the optical domain, and maybe use this kind of a device for microwave to optical transduction, which, as I think many of you know, might be useful for transmitting information from some microwave kind of devices to optical or free space transmission lines. So basically, in all of this, both the memory and this work, we're looking forward to thinking about, how can we start working with true quantum information? What are the domains in which we can store this quantum information, whether in polarization or time bin qubits? We're actually working right now on preparing a single photon source or a real single photon source using the atoms in this case, and learning a lot about experimental quantum optics. And then eventually we want to think about interfacing different quantum memories with different apparatuses across the lab. So let me summarize here. I've talked a lot today about the Autler-Townes memory and the protocol for memory and manipulation. It has reduced technical demands and is inherently broadband efficient and efficient in these low optical depth systems. We've done proof of concept demonstrations for classical signal storage and manipulation at the single photon level and in cold atoms, where we showed increased storage times. And in terms of outlook, we're thinking about things like microwave cavities and how to start working with real quantum states. And of course, I would take any advice any of you can give me about that, because I'm still a little bit new to this sort of more pure quantum information world, and it's been a lot of fun to learn about. So before I end, let me just say thanks to the group. In particular to Erhan Zagomirek, who's a postdoc who's been doing a lot of this work through the years. He's actually moved on to be a research associate part-time here and actually part-time in Calgary, working on some of the collaborations we've got going on with the University of Calgary. And let me also just highlight Anindya Rastogi, who's done a lot of the theory work and is now working on the experiments for quantum memory, and Taras Ryshevsky, who is the one who made the BECs and is now a technical staff in the lab as well. So with that, I'm happy to take any questions and look forward to talking to you all.
Great. Yeah, thank you for that. So we'll take questions, and you can raise your hands. If you go to the participants, you can raise your hand.
See Chris.
Yeah, okay, Chris.
Can I go? Can you hear me? Hi, so Chris Wilson. I work on superconducting qubits. We actually do a lot of stuff with EIT and ATS with superconducting qubits. So I'm just wondering, in your in the simulations or in your measurement, so you showed storing kind of single photon level coherent pulses.
Yes.
But then, so I wonder, and I think about the same problem. A real single photon, a Fock state, will have very different coherence properties. And so since you kind of talk about your memory being very much the evolution of coherences, have you looked at, does the fact that does a Fock state really work the same as a coherent state with on average one photon in terms of the memory? Or have you kind of looked at that or simulated that?
We haven't simulated that. Yeah, I don't see it being too different, but I could be totally wrong on that. I mean, I think, you know, for us, the challenge is thinking about how to encode information in the single photon, whether that's through polarization states, which might have, so I think, you know, this is where the details might matter, and setting up the spin wave with different polarizations with the light, that could matter in the strengths, like the matrix elements that connect the different polarization states, that could be a problem. And also, yeah, the sort of the spin wave mixing that might happen inside the gas. So I think that is something we could simulate and probably is worthwhile. But in terms of, yeah, the sort of actually thinking about the quantum fields, we haven't done anything like that so far.
Okay, thank you. Just curious.
Other questions? Not, maybe I'll ask one of mine. I was curious, you said one of the big decoherence mechanisms is magnetic gradients.
Yes.
Is there something that keeps you from using like clock states that would be less susceptible to that?
Well, I guess no. So we could do that. I guess it would be less, it would still be susceptible, yet, but yes, less susceptible. Right now we're not addressing individual states at all. So I guess that's part of the issue, is that we're just addressing all of the xenon states simultaneously. Again, if we start, you know, actually thinking about polarization specific transitions, then that will become, yeah, that would help. Whether or not we could actually use the clock states, I mean, you'd have to think about the transition elements, because I think, you know, some of them are not going to be allowed, of course. And with the two photon transitions, actually that gets a little tricky too. So it'd be something we'd have to think about, but often there's reasons you can't use these sorts of things.
Yes, Mateo, please.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So I just had a question about when you're working in that single photon limit, and you were looking at the attenuated laser pulses.
Yes.
So if you, and you had, you showed where you can kind of make a beam splitter in effect. Yeah. And so you could do essentially like a 50-50 beam splitting operation by letting out the light at two different times.
Right.
Yeah. So in that case, like if you do have real single photon, photons in the system, you'll effectively get like a superposition of like late and early,
right? Time bin.
Is that what's going on? Okay, so it's a way of creating like time bin photon state.
Oh, that's a good point. Yeah.
Okay. I just wanted to make sure that's kind of what's going on.
Yeah, I think that's right. So actually, to expand a little bit more, we're actually working right now on a single photon source based on the DLCZ protocol, which is very similar to all of this, in warm atoms right now. So yeah, we're sort of thinking about, you know, if there's interesting opportunities for using this sort of ATS limit to actually do the creation of the single photon light as well. I think that's an India's project right now.
All right, see Ray, go ahead.
Very nice talk. A few questions. You mentioned about memory efficiency, and I'm not totally sure what do you mean by this memory.
Sure. So I mean the integrated in time amplitude of the electric field going in versus the same thing going out. So
I'm trying to translate this into, if I have a qubit, what would it correspond to?
I see. I mean, it's the, if you had a cube, so it's sort of like the probability of that when you send a photon in, you will get it out again. So I guess there's two things that happen. One is that, you know, you have a cloud of atoms and you send the light in. So some of it can leak through. So that's a loss of efficiency on the first pass. And then when you go to retrieve it, then it doesn't come out again. So, I mean, this all sort of applies to the single photon case as well, or qubit case. But it isn't really thinking about the information at all in terms of the qubit.
Okay. For example, can I interpret this as if I send a photon in there, what is the probability of the photon coming out without this photon being entangled or whatever with anything else?
That's right. That's another good point. Yes. Is it could be, you're not leaving any information in the like atomic degrees of freedom when you're reading it out.
And in principle, would that kind of memory preserve that quantum information?
Yes, it should. So there's a lot of work that has gone into this about 10 years ago. And they actually showed that if you, instead of retrieving from the same direction, if you retrieve from the opposite direction, it's a time reverse process. And so basically they thought of it in terms of the quantum optical fields, but they're the exact quantum optical field that you put in, you should be able to get out because it's a complete time reverse process.
Okay.
So I interpret that to mean that yes, the information should be the same. It should be all of the same modes of the field that you put in as that you get out.
Okay. And my last question is, if you wanted to build a quantum repeater with this, what would be the memory efficiency that you would need to have a reasonable quantum repeater?
So I think, I don't know the numbers offhand. It's 98 or 99%, I think, is sort of the level. So,
So the bar is quite high.
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Okay, any other last questions? Looks like no. So then we'll just thank Lindsay for a great talk. And if people want to stick around.